want to do is just go through, if you've never shot on a known distance range, we're just going to go through some of the commands, what's expected of you, and how this operates, all right? There's that. Weapon safety again, right? Always treat all weapons if they're loaded. Never point any weapon, anything you don't intend to kill. Keep your finger off the trigger until you sight on the target. Always be sure of your target and surrounding and beyond. And never fry bacon naked, people. That's rough, all right? And if, I'm telling you, okay? If you've ever done it, you'll never do it again, okay? All right, range procedures. Now, tomorrow when we get out there, all range commands come from the center of the line, and that's going to be Master Sergeant Anderson. He's going to have the radio. I'm going to have a radio. We're going to be in the pits. We're going to be talking back and forth, okay? Pay attention and always listen for the commands. Pay attention, guys. This is too easy, all right? Follow all your range commands without any exception. And everybody out here is at range safety. If you see an unsafe act, you may call ceasefire at any time. We tracking? Like a broken VCR in a pawn shop. All right. Okay, commands prior to firing. A safety briefing will be given. There's going to be one given tomorrow morning on the firing line. And then when you come down to the pits tomorrow, I'm going to give you another one, which pertains to what goes on in the pits. All right, for people who have never been on a KD range and in the pits, do you realize how close these rounds are impacting over top of your head? They are coming probably about, what, 3 feet? And that what we talked about earlier is if you're pointing at what you're trying to hit at, don't sit there and screw up and start hitting at the berm, because then you're going to cover your buddy with worm guts and dirt. And that's not fun, because it scatters, okay? Assignments will be given for which relays will remain on the line and which will report to the pits. So, I mean, just take for instance here, we got 1, 2, 3, and 4. We got 4 relays sitting right here. Relays 1 and 2 are on the firing line, 3 and 4 report to the pits, okay? Now, it's big boy rules, as we discussed earlier, okay? When relays 3 and 4 head to the pits, I'm going to get announcement of the pits are sealed. I'm going to call back and I'm going to say, okay, who's the last guy coming around the corner? You know, it's going to be Sergeant so-and-so coming around the corner. And I'm going to relay back and I'm going to say the pits are sealed. Meaning, guys, do not for any reason whatsoever go beyond that wall at all. The pits are sealed. All right, now, relay 1, you're going to take your position on the firing line. Do not handle your rifle. Your preparation period will begin in 2 minutes. Now, what does that mean to us? It means that you can start preparing your gear, whether it be sight, you know, putting black on your sights, putting zeros on your, no, I guess we couldn't do that. If you're behind the firing line, I guess you could handle your rifles, but on the firing line, not to, all right? Getting your equipment ready. Because in 2 minutes, your preparation period will begin, okay? Your 3-minute preparation period will begin when your targets appear. Now, we're going to get into the target tree and all that stuff here in just a few minutes. All right, let's talk about the slow fire range commands. After Relay 1 has had their 3-minute preparation period, your preparation, we will call out on the firing line, your preparation period has ended. This course of fire, course number 360, firing 10 shots, slow fire in a time limit of 10 minutes, okay? It's gonna be all handed to you. You're gonna know everything that's going on, all right? And we discussed earlier about the amber, red, black, green. We're all tracking with that, right? So the command is gonna be given. Amber, red, watch and shoot, watch and shoot. After you finish firing your 10 rounds, you'll be given cease fire, unload. Your time is expired. Remove your magazines and insert your empty chamber indicators. Has everybody seen what an empty chamber indicator is? okay? We're all gonna have them tomorrow, all right? Big boy rules, we clear all our weapons, insert your empty chamber indicators, all right? Then you're gonna have safeties on the firing line. And this is nothing like you've ever done before, as far as we're not gonna be shotgunning weapons, taking the bolt out, and somebody's gonna be coming through with a brass rod, slamming it down in there. We're not gonna do that. You're gonna be clearing your own weapon, putting it on safe, putting your empty chamber indicator in. Once that's done, and everybody's on the same sheet of music, we're gonna call the firing line clear, okay? Now, relay one, you're gonna remove all your gear and all equipment from the firing line, do a police, brass and trash call. Okay, you'll have time to do that. Pick up your brass, pick up your trash, and exit the firing line. Now, relay two, or the next relay, take your position on the firing line when the point is vacant. Don't try to hurry up, you're gonna get plenty of time to do this. All right, do not handle your weapons. Your preparation period will begin in approximately 2 minutes. We've seen a pattern here. This is how we do our firing, our shooting in these competitive sports, and it runs like a smooth old machine. All right, so now the first relay that had just fired picked up his brass and his trash, and he's got all the stuff behind the firing line. He becomes the scorekeeper for the guy that's up on the firing line right now. You just basically flip-flopped, okay? All right, now we just talked about the slow fire. All right, now rapid fire. Basically the same thing, your preparation period has ended, you do your preparation time, all right? Your next string of fire will be rapid fire, or kneeling or prone from standing, 10 shots fired, in a time limit of 60 to 120 seconds. All right, now, if by show of hands, how many people would really like to have about 5 extra points on their scorecard tomorrow? It'd be kind of nice, wouldn't it? All right. By being in the pits, look to your left, look to your right, look at your buddy to your left and your right. He could be the person pulling your target. Okay? Would you want to give your friend, your fellow soldier, the best possible pit service that you can give him? Because think about it, right? I mean, we all got cell phones out here, and most of us are all married. You get a text message, right? Lipstick 6 calls you because what? You forgot to take out the trash, and you left the dog in the house, and it left you a really nice something in the carpet, and she's pissed. Am I right or wrong? Things happen, right? You get text messages. But while you're sitting there text messaging Lipstick 6 back, pulling mark target number 16. Oh crap, that's me. You know, and you've done wasted that person's time on the firing line. All right, are you following me now? Give that person the best possible pit service that you can give, because then in return, they'll give that to you. Okay? So, while we're talking about rapid fire, the same procedures are the same things occur. On the firing line, shooters, amber, red, watch and shoot, okay? Next, the command you're gonna hear is cease fire, unload. Remain in position until the line is clear. You're gonna have safeties walking up and down the line, making sure that the weapons are clear, the empty chamber indicators inserted into the weapon, and the weapon is on safe. And then they're gonna ask, are there any saved rounds? Anything could happen. You could have a malfunction. You could have a stovepipe. Something could happen. All right? If something like that happens, just stop and raise your hand. Raise your hand. You got a safety right there. He's going to come and visually inspect and see what that, and you will get an additional chance to shoot and refire. Okay? But here's the deal. If you have a malfunction, you immediately correct it. That means you accepted the conditions and you drove on. So if you have a malfunction, just stop. Stop doing what you're doing and raise your hand, all right? Remove the magazines, insert the open bolt and chamber indicators, place the weapon on safe, firing line clear. Firing line is clear, okay? And here we go again. Relay one fired his rapid fire. And you're going to be told to police up your brass and trash, move off the firing line. And then relay two is going to do the same thing. He's going to move up when that position's vacant. All right? It's just, it runs real smooth. All right? There's no jackassery. There's no getting yelled at, getting screamed at, and, you know, get off the firing line, you know, do this, that, and brass rod down. We don't play that game. Okay? All right. Some of the pit commands that you're going to hear. Stand by your targets. Half mast your targets. Targets up, targets down. Too easy. Mark, paste, or clean up your targets. Depending on what course of fire we're shooting at that particular moment, it's going to depict on what we're going to be doing. Okay? Now, I discussed a little bit earlier. What? What did we say about 3 feet? All right, so when tomorrow morning when I give my pit briefing, you know, if there's anything you want to keep, hands, fingers, toes, don't sit there and say, well, I'm gonna stand up on this bucket and I'm gonna look up and see if it's going up over the berm. No, like I said, it's not very far. You're gonna have rounds impacting over top of your head. All right, so everything stays hands inside the vehicle at all times. All right. This is the picture of stand by your targets. You can't really see it all that well. All right? What's that?
So I promise you, standing by your targets.
Stand by your targets. All right? Now, when I say go to half mast, bring half that target up out of the pits. All right? Half mast your targets. And that's a really good indication from the guy on the firing line, running the commands on the firing line, to let the firing line know that we, in the pits, are all ready. Targets are pasted up. We're ready to go for the next iteration. All right? Half-mast the targets. When they're all at half-mast, then the firing line can continue. Okay? Targets up. Targets all the way up in the air. I mean, that's pretty cut and dry. All right, now let's talk about your chalkboard. Tomorrow, not only are you going to be in the pits and get this high-speed target that runs up and down in the air, you're also going to get these wonderful pieces of equipment. You're going to get a chalkboard. You're going to get a 3-inch spotter. You're going to get a 5-inch spotter, and you're going to get pasters, white pasters and black pasters. All right? When you're pasting up your holes, if that round that impacts into that target is going into the black portion of the target, are you going to paste it up with a white paster or are you going to place it up with a black paster? All right. I got to ask that question because I have seen it before in the past. All right. Ooh, just the hell with it. Okay. I have seen it. Okay. Your chalkboard, it's got a B, 5, 4, 3, all the way down to a miss. All right. When we're, let me see if we're, okay, slow firing scoring procedures, all right? Once you verify that you have had a hit, now I don't know, I have not been into the pits in this, I have been told that some of them, a portion of the range kind of doesn't get used a lot, so there's some kind of grassy areas and stuff like that. And as you're standing in front of the pits like this and your target's up there, you might want to look up and verify that it has been hit. You'll hear a loud crack over top of your head, I mean, but you might hear from the left to your right. You want to physically verify, look up. If you can't physically see the round impacting into the berm because there's grass, you want to be focusing on that target up there. As soon as that target has an impact on it, you want to pull it down. All right, now you remember, let me back up here a second. We've got the 3-inch spotter and the 5-inch spotter, okay? We want to put the 3-inch spotter into the hole where the round impacted. Now here's the next question. do you want, if it hit in the black, do you want to put the black portion of the spotter in or the white one? The white side, all right? You want to be able to fit, they want to be on the firing line, want to be able to see exactly where they hit. Now, we'll show here in the next few slides where you're supposed to put the score, all right? The value of that actual target, because you're going to have, like on the chalkboard, you're going to have a V543. And you want to mark it so that they can actually see what their scoring is. Here's another question. All right. Say they shot and it's right on the line of the five ring. It's touching the five ring. It almost looks like it's in the four ring. If it's breaking that line, do they get the next value higher? If you have any questions, I'm your friendly neighborhood pit officer. I'll be there all day tomorrow with a thermos of coffee freezing my ass off. All right? Just standing down there all day. All right? There'll be another soldier down there, Master Sergeant Cooner. He'll be down there to help me out. All right? If you have any questions, if you have anything, if any questions at all about, I don't know if that's a 5, I don't know if it's a V, it's kind of close, can you verify it for me? Not a problem. That's what we're here for. All right? So, you want to insert the spotter into the shot hole, locate the corresponding value, and insert the scoring disc. Run that target back up in the air. Now, how fast do you think this process should take? How many seconds? 30? You should be able to do this in about 10 to 12 seconds. 10 to 12 seconds is all that should take you. From the time that round impacts that target, it should be pulled down, marked, pasted up, run that thing back up in the air. As I said before, that could affect, I kid you not, if you get poor pit service, that could affect your score, your performance and your score. Because what happens, like I said, you know, he's texting his wife because, you know, he forgot to take out the trash and he's not paying attention to that shot hole. You're on the firing line, you're getting frustrated, right? Because your buddy down in the pits isn't paying attention. All that affects, has an effect. Go ahead. Say what? As far as I know, there's going to be two relays online, two in the pits.
I have to look at it because we're shooting rifle and pistol.
We're shooting rifle and pistol. Are we going to heat? The question was, sir, are there going to be two relays in the pits and two relays online? So we're going to have two people. Okay, question answered. All right. And like I said, always, I keep stressing this, always strive to give better pit service than you received. Take care of your buddies and they'll take care of you. Okay? Okay, on what I call the dog face target, you can see that you've got a V, a 5, 4, 3, and 2. All right, now it'll be clearly marked tomorrow on the targets. Where the V's, the 5, where your shot corresponding, where the score is supposed to go. Alright? Now that's with the 5-inch spotter. Alright? And make sure, as I can't stress enough, and it's going to happen tomorrow. Somebody's going to say, pull and re-disc target number 1-5 or 1-6 or whatever, because you're tracking, you're working on it, but you want to give that guy the best pit service you can, and all of a sudden, boom, you just threw that 3-inch spotter black on black and threw it back up. Now they can't see where they hit. They saw this. They see they shot a 5, and it happens. But don't worry about it. You know, we'll work on it and drive on. Okay? So the 5-inch spotter's for your value marker, and the 3-inch spotter's for your shot hole marker. All right? All right, here's your E-type silhouette, and you can actually see it better on the laptop. But it's got your X, 5, your 4, your 3, and your 2. All right, same thing goes. 5-inch spotter's your value marker. Your 3-inch spotter's your shot hole marker. All right. This one's going to be pretty easy because it's going to be all white markers in the E-Type silhouette, unless somebody shoots way the heck out in left field on the 6x6. But we're not going to have that tomorrow, right? Because we're going to be zeroed, and we're going to hit the E-Type silhouette every single time. All right? Let's talk about rapid-fire scoring procedures. All right? This is how it's going to work. On a rapid-fire string, we're going to pull all targets into the pits, and then it has a correct number of shots. Okay, say you've got a rapid-fire string of 10 rounds. All right? Targets are at half-mast. The line calls, ready on the right, ready on the left, all ready on the firing line. That tells me down in the pits that the firing line is ready, and we're going to run our targets up for, say, 60 seconds. All right? Once those targets, when I say stand by your targets, targets up on a rapid fire string, as soon as they are up in the air, I want you guys to back up and stand up against the wall, all right? Because you've got a lot of lead headed your way, all right? You don't want to take any chances. Do not touch the targets until told to do so, all right? When I get to about, say, if it's 60 seconds, when I get to about 45 seconds, I'm going to sit there and tell you, okay, stand by your targets. You walk up, you grab a hold, stand by your targets. At the end of 60 seconds, I'm going to say targets down. Pull all targets into the pits. Now, before you start plugging holes and scoring things, I want you to verify, and you could also do this as you're standing up against the wall, and it's also a good thing to do it as well, is to look up and count your impacts to verify that they've had 10 shots, okay? Because it has happened, and it will always happen, that somebody get excited, and you could be on target number 14, and you could be on target number 16, and for some reason, you decided to shoot your buddy's target two doors down. It happens, all right? You might have insufficient hits. Target number 14 might have 12 hits because target number 15 might have said, oh my God, I just fired two on him, but I got to, you know what I'm saying? It could actually, you could have excessive hits, insufficient hits, and it's always better to count your shot holes. Once they're down in the pits, say you've got 10 holes, you take your golf tees and you plug them in there, as long as you got 10 holes, and then I want you to take your chalkboard with your chalk, and I want you to verify and write the corresponding numbers. He's got four V's, two fives, and four fours. All right? Put that up, and then I want you to go to half mast. Go ahead.
What would you do if, say, there are like 12 shots over? How would you grade that?
How would you grade it? No, see, what will happen is, did everybody hear the question? All right? The question was that if he had 12 hits, all right, 12 hits on number target number 15, that shooter will get the benefit of the doubt and get the highest number. All right? You take out the lowest two rounds, and that's what he would get. He would get the benefit of the doubt. Any other questions on that? The less amount, all right, that's why you're going to look and verify the hit. So he's got 8 rounds, all right. You're going to look to the left, and you're going to look to the right. See if there's excessive hits on your buddy's targets. If there is, you know where they went, all right. If there's not, you're going to come and yell at me and say, hey, darn G, I got insufficient hits on target number 16. That way I can radio up to the firing line and say, okay, we've got insufficient hits on 16. What's the deal? They're going to say, okay, he had a malfunction, or he saw this 12-point buck and just had to shoot it. I mean, come on. It's hunting season back home for me. I wish like heck I was out there hunting, but I wasn't allowed to bring my gun, so maybe we'll see something. But, yeah, anything's possible. All right? So if it's insufficient hits, he can either accept that.
No, there's no refires.
Oh, there's no refires in the EIC match. All right. No refires. Now what if there's a malfunction? All right, so I misinformed this crew.
Well, I we'll have to verify. Just stand by for what, you know, what the word law of the land is going to be.
All right. Okay. Insufficient hits, it's either he accepts it and score and run it. Okay?
But always contact somebody that fits. If there's insufficient or excessive, don't try to figure it out yourself. Because either way, Sergeant G's going to have to call that to the fire line. So don't touch the target. Don't run into any golf tees. Don't do anything. Just count 12 up. Hey, I got 12, you know, excessive hits on target 7. Or if you only have 9 hits, don't touch the target. Don't run in golf tees. Just holler at the center of the pits. Say, hey, I got 9 insufficient on target 8. Whatever it is. If you got insufficient or excessive, don't touch the target. Call for one of these guys to come help you.
To say he's got insufficient hits. Say he's got 9 hits and you can't find that 10th hole. Is it possible with the weapons and ammo that we're shooting that you could have had a keyhole? Anybody know what a keyhole is? All right. It's possible. It very well is. So by saying I've got insufficient hits and not plugging that up, couple more sets of eyes wouldn't hurt to go on there and say, hey, you know, that's a little bit bigger right there. We've got actual tools to plug a hole and say, hey, that's 2 holes right there. You had a round pass through the same hole twice. All right? That is a possibility. So give, like we just talked about earlier, I keep reinforcing it, give your buddy the best pit service you possibly can. Okay? So, as we're going through again, reiterate, pull the target into the pits, ensure that it has the correct number of shot holes. 10 for 10, 9 insufficient or sufficient hits, okay? Only if the correct number of shot holes is visible, insert your shot spotters or golf tees into the shot holes. We discussed that. Write the corresponding numbers of the shots of each value on the scoreboard, ensuring that the number of hits equal 10. Hang your scoreboard up on the left side, on the left corner, as you're staring at the target on the left side, and then bring your target to half-mast. All right, once everybody's at half-mast, I will see that, and I'll raise the targets up. Run them up in the air for score, okay? All right, some of the things you might run into, inadvertently pull target. It happens from time to time. I'll usually be Johnny on the spot, hopefully, tomorrow, with, all right, this is slow fire, and pull a mark each target, or this is rapid fire. Once the targets go up, I want you to back and step away from your target, all right? But as the day goes on, you may have a brain cramp there and realize that it's rapid fire. You don't realize it's rapid fire, and that first shot goes down. And I've seen it. I've had it happen to me at Camp Perry. Somebody pulled the target out from underneath me. In a rapid fire string. It has happened. Okay? Now, call for a mark or no shot visible. 2 things that could happen. Try to keep your texting. Keep your phone in your pockets. Don't worry about household 6. Leave it in the pits. All right? Turn it off, okay? Or no shot visible. Target number 16 actually fired a round. And you're just sitting there. And we're gonna get a call, pulling mark 16. You know, they say he shot, they say he fired a round. But when you pull it down, one of us will be up there helping you out as well. Because there may be something that you're not seeing, especially with the scoring rings. It may be a spot where that round impacted where you just didn't happen to see it, okay? Or he may be, the shooter may have done something, shot on the next one over, crossfired. Or his gun may have went down, so to speak. Anything can happen, all right? And we discussed the rapid fire. Insufficient or too many shots. All right. Is everybody on board with what's going on so far? All right. It's going to be too easy tomorrow. We're going to have a good time.